if you would please, if you're able, rise. And let me read for you this scripture. 1 Corinthians, I'll read the first seven verses and then verses 10 through 12. So it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I didn't come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony of God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith may not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. And then skip down to verse 10. For these are the things that God revealed to us by His Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who's from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So, this was a congregation that had experienced some bumps. Yeah, I got a speed bump there. It happens in congregations, right? It happens in churches. I mean, people are always think that it's never going to happen, but then it does. It happens in churches. In this case, some of the bumps were pastoral in nature. Some people said that they were the followers of Paul. They began to choose up sides, you know. And so some people were saying, we are the Paul people. And other people said, no, no, it's Apollos. And Apollos was that great eloquent preacher. So some people said, you know, we follow Apollos. And others said Cephas, which is the Aramaic for Peter. And then some people said Christ. And you think, well, that's the right answer, except that I expect that these people said Christ in the way that was divisive, in the way that said, we have Christ and you don't. This was the beginning of denominationalism, right? I mean, people saying, we have the right person or the right pastor or the right idea or the right spirituality or whatever it is. You know what I'm saying? There were bumps in this church. Corinth is a city, which is way on, I should have had a map up here, but it's way on the southern area in Greece. It was a very important city, third biggest city in the Roman Empire. It was a commercial center. It was an educational center. It was a sophisticated city. And it was a city in which this church grew up and thought that they were a church which had it all right. But they ran into bumps. And there was more stuff going on. Oh, I should. Paul's upset about this. He says, I love this section, by the way. I put this up in part because it shows you what preachers do. And Paul, you know, after he goes through that little litany and says, some Paul, some Apollos, some Cephas, some Christ, he says, is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? And then, I love this. I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one could say that you were baptized in my name. Well, yeah, I mean, I did baptize the household of Stephanus. Oh, yeah, and beyond that, I don't remember who I baptized anybody else. I would have done this, you know? I baptized nobody. Oh, yeah, but there was this person. So. Paul's humanity shows through, which is part of the point here. And maybe he lets it happen in part. Because the church is always divinity wrapped in humanity. The Spirit wrapped in human flesh. You know, the church isn't the building. It's you who are sitting here in front of me. And we're human. Paul lets his humanity show through. So there were lots of stuff going on. There was a man who was having a relationship, not a relationship, he was sleeping with his stepmother, his father's wife, it says in the script. So his stepmother, and Paul says, that's not what's supposed to happen. And then there were Christians inside the community, and I don't know how big this community was, but who were suing each other. There was all kinds of dissension. There were bumps. And some of it goes back to spiritual arrogance. You know, I talked a little bit about this as a kind of being one of those cities. It's one of those cities with an attitude, you know. We are good. We are Corinth, that sort of thing. And so there was a theology, a kind of theology of victory. Premature victory, let's call it. These are people who talked a lot about victory, who said, you know, we have achieved victory, but they really didn't realize that what they were declaring as victory was simply human stuff and not divine. Paul says he's mocking them. This is chapter 4. Already you have all you want. Already you become rich. You started to reign, victory, and that without us. How I wish that you really had begun to reign so that we might also reign with you. And the we there is the apostles. And then he goes into a metaphor about the apostles, that the apostles are like prisoners of war being drugged through the city at the back of the parade with, you know, chains on. It isn't always easy. Be careful. Be careful. He says that when he came there, he was nervous. Yeah, that's a nervous preacher. that's me when I first got at Cross Point, you know? Back when I was still wearing a clerical collar. He says, I was unsure about how to go about this. This is the Message translation. Felt totally inadequate. Scared to death, if you want the truth of it. Nothing I said could have impressed you or anyone else. Pastor Brian preached on the first Sunday I was here, his farewell sermon. Pastor Bob preached his farewell sermon the next Sunday, and then it was me. And I remember standing for the first time on this platform and wondering if anybody here would hear anything I had to say. I was a little scared. I had some trepidation. I was told that Cross Point was that kind of church, you know? That it was the kind of church where there had been some bumps, some stuff, where there were divisions, and underlying it a kind of spiritual arrogance. I was told all this by lots of different kinds of people. It turned out all to be false. Instead, what I found here was love. What I found here was a people eager to be the people of God. What I found here is a great diversity of the ways that people worship and think, and yet that diversity is included in a body. And I know that body isn't always all one thing, but it can be, and it is becoming one body. We are. This is a great church. Yeah. Not because of who you are. And that's the message here this morning. But because what God is doing in you. And so what I thought I'd do is kind of pause a little bit this morning on things that we have learned along the way about church. When Paul came to this church, he said, I came resolved to know nothing while I was with you. This is chapter 1 or chapter 2, the second verse. Know nothing while I was with you except Jesus and him crucified. All those words are important. He says, I decided that since I was going to preach to this very sophisticated people who knew everything there was about theology and who I thought might eat me up, I decided to only do a very simple thing, preach Jesus and preach Jesus crucified. And the crucified is important because it says, I'm not going to preach a triumphalist Christ. I'm going to preach Jesus on the cross. I've tried to do that here. I think the biggest question for churches today in the United States of America and maybe in many other places is, who is the Jesus that we worship? Is it the Jesus of Scripture, or is it the Jesus that we invent? Because it's very easy to say the word Jesus and talk about Jesus and sing to Jesus and yet have in mind someone who doesn't resemble Jesus at all. So that the values of the Christian or the values of the church have nothing to do with who Jesus really is. So the first thing I want to say to you this morning is, as you go forward, put Jesus first. Used to have an old question I'd ask new members' classes. I'd say, so what does it mean to be a follower? What does it mean to be a Christian? And the answer I would always give is, be a follower of Jesus. Just follow Jesus. Start there. Start with Jesus. And if you want to start with Jesus, you can do a lot worse than start with the Sermon on the Mount. We're talking about that in the class on Tuesday morning, 6:30 in the morning, the Men Connect class. And so you get, you know, that great sermon that starts, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And talks about being salt and light. It talks about a righteousness which is different from, greater than, the righteousness of religious people, the scribes and the Pharisees. It talks about turning the other cheek. It talks about loving your enemies. Imagine that in this world. It talks about prayer, and it gives to us the Lord's Prayer, and it gives us the Lord's Prayer as a pattern for how to pray. Your will be done, you know, that kind of prayer. Modest prayers. Give us today our daily bread, that kind of prayer. It talks about storing up treasures in heaven. It talks about not being anxious about anything, because we're able to go through life with not worrying that God won't provide for us. It talks about not judging. It talks about seeking and knocking. It talks about the narrow way. It talks about building your house on the rock. Start there. Put Jesus at the center of your faith and your church. Second thing, and it's related, Paul spends a lot of time on this in these first two chapters. You should read them through. Is understand what strength is. We talked just briefly about that because I've been reflecting on it. It kind of pops into my head. In the Easter sermon, I said we could probably do a whole series on the views of power in the New Testament. The New Testament looks at power in a different way than we look at power. What we think of as being powerful, the New Testament says, isn't powerful at all. It's crashing down. It's this world. It will come to an end. And what we think as being weakness is actually power. We preach Christ crucified, says Paul. Stumbling block to the Jews, foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God, I'll come to the foolishness of God in a moment, is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Sometimes true strength looks like weakness. When are we strongest? A lot of churches think they're strong when they have all their ducks in a row. You know, so if, you know, they know exactly what they think. They proclaim it. They put it out there. They are fierce on their whatever their teaching is and that sort of thing. And they, you know, they got it all together. I don't think that's necessarily strength. I think we're strongest when we weep together and mourn together. I think we're strongest when we say to each other, I'm sorry. I think we're strongest when we're broken people and we acknowledge our brokenness. Who's the strongest person I ever knew? Well, I'd give this person a candidate for that honor. The woman there on the right in the wheelchair, her name is Gloria Holsema. That's her husband, Dan, alongside of her, and her two kids behind her. All the time that I ever knew Gloria, probably 25 years that I knew Gloria, she was a victim of MS, and not the kind of MS that sometimes comes and remits, but the kind of MS that's progressive. She said to me, one of the first times I met her, I remember this, she said to me, Clay, every time I lose something, I never get it back. And when you see her there in that picture, in that wheelchair, she cannot literally, she cannot lift a finger. She cannot move a muscle. She cannot, her voice is so weak that you have to lean in to hear it. And yet she was the soul of the church. It would be some, you know, this is in Michigan, it would be some snowy day and, you know, everybody would be going crazy about canceling schools and canceling churches and all that kind of stuff. And we'd all be running around saying, well, we got to call everybody or put it on the news or whatever, say that the church is canceled. And we'd look and there right behind us would be Gloria and Dan. They'd make it, you know. Nobody else did. The people that were, you know, living next door, they didn't make it. But Gloria and Dan, they made it. They were strong people. You see the girl with the graduation outfit on? Her name is Blessing. Long time ago, well, you can tell how long ago by the age of Blessing in the picture. Gloria and Dan came to me and said, we're pregnant. And the doctors are saying that we shouldn't have the baby because it will set off Gloria's MS. And I said to Gloria, what do you want to do? And she said, I want to have the baby. And they had the baby. And her name is Blessing. Gloria died about 3 or 4 months ago. She raised a family. She told me a long time ago that when Jeremy graduated from high school, that then she was able to die. That was how long she would hold up. Well, about 25 years later, she was still alive. Now, you take somebody in a big pumped-up pickup truck who wants to intimidate you on the freeway and threatens violence, and that person says, I'm strong. Who is really the strongest, him or Gloria? And you can take that and you can bring that into all of life. Sometimes strength, the Jesus strength, looks like weakness. You're strongest when you're the most vulnerable. You're strongest when you are the people who can be broken. And Paul adds to that foolishness. He says sometimes what's wise looks like foolishness. He says you think that you're pretty wise people, but you're not. And then he kind of does this little thing, which is true for every church. Not many of you are wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. That means that he chose us, chose me, chose you, because we're the foolish things of the world. And he poured his message into us. Used a whole idea, a different idea, what it means to be the people of God. Yeah? So what does divine foolishness that is actually wisdom look like? Well, one of the things I think it looks like is laughter, and you laugh here, and I love that. There can be a kind of silliness, a foolishness sometimes we want to be really serious people, and we're tempted in churches to become really serious people. And the serious people are usually people who are judgmental to all the other people. But a congregation that can laugh together and enjoy life together is a congregation that's filled with grace. Sometimes wisdom looks like foolishness. But that's only the beginning, okay? Paul talks about the mystery. There's that paragraph, you know, that starts this way. We declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. What that says, what Paul's saying there is that there has been a mystery unveiled, and the mystery is the mystery of the cross, and the mystery is the mystery that it's no longer a message simply for one people, but a message for all people, that it's a message for the nations, that God is spreading his message out into the world, and that we are part of God spreading his message into the world. And so there's this mystery. God would do it this way. Which to me ends judgment. We ought to be surprised by it, daily surprised by it. Me, I am surprised by it. Why should I be standing up here? What wisdom do I have? I don't have any wisdom. I don't know all that much. And yet, God uses us, me, okay? We ought to keep that mystery in mind. We ought to always, in our life together as a congregation, be the kind of congregation which says there's more here to understand, there's more here to know than we can ever know, to walk up to the edge of that mystery. And then look into the eyes of God. Sometimes strength looks like weakness, and sometimes wisdom looks like mystery. And then last, and I'll be kind of brief on this one. Listen for the thoughts of God. There is that complicated paragraph in chapter 2 that starts, the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God, for who knows a person's thoughts except for their spirit within them. And you can easily get mixed, you know, and then you read through this paragraph, you can easily find yourself saying, now what exactly is he saying? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. The whole idea that the Spirit is the thoughts of God, that God thinks and his Spirit contains his thoughts. And then Paul works it down, and I'm not going to go through the whole thing, and then he ends up this way. He says, and who knows the mind of God? I mean, who knows? So as to instruct God. But we have the mind of Jesus. Philippians 2, huh? That's where I'm taken, Philippians 2. In your relationship with one another, have the mind of Jesus Christ, who being in very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, and on it goes. That's the mind of Christ. It's humility. It's that way of life which is giving. It's that way of life which says that if you try to grab your life, you're going to lose it. And if you lose your life, if you give your life away, you're going to gain it. Crosspoint has had a long and kind of interesting history. And in that history, we have been instructed, we have learned. And all I've done this morning, and all I've done perhaps in this whole year, is draw out some of the lessons that you have learned together. And the lessons are, put Jesus first. That sometimes what looks like strength, you know, the big church, is actually weakness. And what looks like weakness when we're broken is strength. And sometimes what looks like wisdom is foolishness, and what looks like foolishness is actually wisdom. And through all of it, what we are called called to do is to be people of prayer, which means that we need to be listening to God. The kind of prayer which is the most valuable in a church is the prayer in which you simply listen to God, and God's not going to say to you, do this, do that. Sometimes he does, but not usually. He's going to say, be this and be that. I hope that Crosspoint Church will never depart from these things. That the soul that I've found here, the spirit that I've found here, the spirit which has sometimes been created in brokenness, will always be here. That when I come back, when Adria comes back with me, that we'll recognize you, that we'll recognize you because you are the people who get this, who understand it, who are still listening to God and going forth in his grace and his glory. Pray with me. Lord God, thank you for Crosspoint Church. Thank you for all it's meant to Adria and I. Thank you for the way that you have instructed us together. I thank you for the lessons that you've taught us. Help us, Lord, never to be bigger than we are, never to be more arrogant than we are, never to be sure than we are, but to embrace the cross, to preach always at the center of this congregation, Jesus Christ and him crucified. In the name of Jesus, amen.